Hello and welcome to the course on mechatronics. So we are dealing with unit number 5 of this subject, that is title of this unit is Frequency Domain Modeling and Analysis. I am Dr. L.S. Dhamande from Sanjini College of Engineering. So in the previous part we have seen how we can make a mathematical model for any particular mechanical, thermal or the fluid system. Here we are trying to get the relationship between the output and the input of a particular system. So when we obtain the transfer function, so actually the transfer function will be having some polynomial term in the numerator and some polynomial term in the denominator. So when we use the polynomial terms in the numerator, that is called as the zeros of that particular transfer function, and denominator polynomial if we use, that is called as poles of the transfer function. So we will again give some more details about this poles and zeros in this particular content. So basically we have seen that for all the initial conditions, if the response of the system decays to equilibrium, the system is pre-assumed to be stable at large. So we are talking about the stability of a system. So when we can say that the system is stable, only when the all initial conditions and response of the system decays to equilibrium position. Because initially if we disturb the system, so their disturbance may cause certain movement of the system, but after some time it will get stable. So it is required that for a system to be stable, the output should remain bounded for a bounded input. And if the disturbance is given to the system should be able to recover from it and come back to the stable position once again. So now we will define what is absolute stability. So absolute stability is nothing but whether the system is stable or it is not stable. Relative stability is nothing but called as the stable under what conditions. So there will be certain conditions under which it will be stable. So that is called as relative stability. The real part of the poles of a given system must be on the left side of the S-plane for the system to be stable. That means when we are going to mark these poles and zeros in the S-plane, so we have seen in the previous video that the real part of the poles, if they are on the left side of the S-plane, then we can say that the system is in stable. So one advantage of this frequency response approach is that we can use the data obtained from the measurements on the physical system without deriving its mathematical model. That is the advantage of it. It means this frequency response functions actually we are calculating by experimentally, because some systems which are very complicated, because if the system is first order system, second order system, then we may be able to make the body plots and draw some conclusions from that. But when the system is more complex, in that case it is very difficult to know the frequency response. So this is possible by doing the measurement by using suitable instrumentation. So now we will see the stability analysis based on the location of the poles. So how you will decide that by knowing the position or location of the poles, the system is stable or not. So the system has number of poles which are equal to the order of the system. So if it is second order system, so it will be having two poles, and number of zeros is always one less than the number of poles. So poles and zeros may be real or complex. So any kind of poles and zeros can be obtained. Real may be there, or maybe a complex poles and zeros may be there. So in case the poles are complex, conjugate pair, their real part must be negative for the system to be stable. And if any one of the poles have a value zero, the system is deemed to be marginally stable. And if the poles are positive or have a positive real part, the system is deemed to be unstable. So definitely if it is having real part positive, it will be unstable. So next we will see the stability analysis by Ruth-Hurwitz criteria. Now what exactly this Ruth-Hurwitz criteria is? So it is a mathematical test to generate sufficient conditions for assessment of stability of linear time invariant systems. So for stability, all coefficients of the characteristic equation need to be positive, and there should be no sign change in the first column of the Ruth Hurwitz table. So what exactly this Ruth Hurwitz table is, that you can see here. So here you will find that suppose there is some expression like this, or some polynomial is there, which is, you can see here, the coefficient of this s raised to 5 is a5, s raised to 4 it is a4, s raised to 3 it is a3, s raised to 2 it is a2, like that. Okay, this polynomial is equal to 0. Now we have to write the coefficients of this all s5, s4, s3, s2, s1 and s0 over here. So coefficient of s5 will be written as a5 here, then a4 here, after that a3, a2, a1, a0. So after writing this all coefficients from a5 to a0, then we have to find out the coefficient of this s3 as a b1. This can be obtained by doing the cross multiplication, like this into this. Okay, like a4 multiplied by a3 minus this a5 into a2, this product, this into this, divided by this a4 to get the value of this b1. Then similarly, to get the value of this c1, you are going to multiply this b1, this I will take another color for that. So this b1 into this a2, okay, then a5. So to get this c1, you are using this b1 into a2, like this cross multiplication, and this a4 into this b2, like this. This cross multiplication we will get like this. Similarly, you have to get the d1, similarly you have to get the e1. And here now b2, to get this b2, this a4 multiplied by a1. So this is a4 here, this is a1 here, okay, minus a5 into this 0. Let me mark it, how you can calculate that b2. So it will be this into this multiply by this into this, okay. Similarly, c2 will be calculated, this b1 multiply by a0, a4 minus 0, okay. So this way we can complete this particular table. So after completing this, then we have to know the values of this, and you have to make the observation in the first column. So here one example is taken. In this case, the equation is like this: s4 plus 2s cube plus 3s square plus 4s plus 5 equal to 0. So I will write first of all the coefficients of this s4, that is 1, then s3, it is s raised to 3, it is 2, then s square, its coefficient is 3, and s, it is 4, then this constant 5, and finally it is 0. And then I will make the cross multiplication, 2 into 3, that is 6, 6 minus 4 divided by 2, so 6 minus 4 is 2, 2 divided by 2 is equal to 1. So like this I will calculate all these values. Now in the above example, there are two sign changes in the first column. So first it is positive to negative, and negative to again it is positive. So the system has two poles on the right hand side of the PZ map. So you can say that the system is unstable, because there are two positive poles and one negative pole is there. So this particular system is an unstable system. This is what we can find out the stability of a system by using this Ruth Hurwitz criteria. Similarly, we will take one more example. So in this example now, we will see that s raised to 4 plus 3s cube plus 3s square plus 2s plus k, this is the example given. So again we will write the coefficients of this, that is s raised to 4, its coefficient is 1, s raised to 3, its coefficient is 3, s raised to 2, its coefficient is 3 again, and s, its coefficient is 2, and there is one constant suppose in this case, which is we are supposed to determine to have the, to know the stability of the system, or to make the system stable we can adjust the value of this particular k. So in a similar way we will calculate these other coefficients here in this particular table, and we will observe this particular first column. So in the above situation, for the system to be stable, so k has to be greater than 0 but lesser than 14 by 9. So this is what is the condition to be satisfied for making this particular system to be stable. So now we will go for understanding the time versus frequency domain. So time domain signal, we know that in case of time domain signal, actually we are using the x axis as a time and y axis will be the amplitude of the system. So if you consider any mechanical system having spring mass and damper, so if we disturb that system, it will start vibrating. So oscillations will be observed. So magnitude of oscillation will be in the y axis, and along the x axis there is a time. And now if the system will be having some more number of components, so different components will be vibrating with different frequencies. So we can see that actually in time domain there is all the addition of the different signals will be indicated there in the time domain. But if you have to understand that how many different frequency components are there in the signal, in that case you have to observe that particular signal in the frequency domain. So for example, suppose this particular signal is constructed by using this one particular frequency signal and this another frequency signal. So addition of these two will be visible to you in the time domain. But if I observe it in the frequency domain, I can identify it clearly that this particular signal, its amplitude and its frequency will be observed in the frequency domain. The second signal, its amplitude and its frequency. So it is very easy to detect the frequencies in the signal if you do this frequency analysis. It means time domain will be converted into frequency domain. So the frequency domain analysis of a system is defined as the steady state response of the system to a sinusoidal input signal. So we are giving some sinusoidal input signal to understand how the system is going to behave or how the system is going to respond to the sinusoidal input signal. Generally, the sinusoid is a unique input signal, and the resulting output signal for a linear system as well as signals throughout the system is sinusoidal in the steady state. So output can also will be observed as a sinusoidal signal. So output differs from the input only in the amplitude and the phase. So amplitude will be different and the phase will be different, but it will be also sinusoidal only, means output will also will be sinusoidal. So what exactly mean by frequency response? So as I just told you that when you are giving some sinusoidal input to the system and you are going to observe its response, so the output will also will look like a transient response, and after some time it becomes a steady state response. So initially it may be transient when we give some input to the system, but after that it becomes a stable steady state response we will get. So when the input is initially applied, there is some form of transient behavior which eventually dies out, and what is left is the steady state response, so which persists until the input is removed. This steady state response will be sinusoidal. So important points here to be noted are the input frequency is equal to output frequency, and there will be a change in amplitude and phase between the input and the output, and this change will vary from frequency to frequency. So this is like when we solve any differential equations, we are getting the complementary function and the particular integral. So that is nothing but the, we write generally CF and PI. So that is nothing but this part, that is transient function and the steady state response of the system. So frequency domain analysis of the system, in this case now we will understand that the frequency domain analysis is a better option with respect to the higher order system, because for higher order system we already discussed that in the frequency in the equation is of a very higher order, then in that case it is very difficult to determine analytically the solution of the response of that particular higher order systems. So frequency domain analysis is better suited when it comes to determining the sensitivity of the system to uncertainty. For example, the uncertainty in the parameter, in the process variation, or that may be mechanical or electrical noise. So frequency domain analysis is better suited when it comes to assessing relative stability of the system. So input applied is in the form of a sine wave, as we discussed that suppose we are giving some input R of t that is equal to A sine of omega t, and the output of the system is also some form of sine wave given by y of t is equal to capital Y sine of omega t plus phi. So there is a difference of phi over there, and the amplitude will be different. In this case amplitude is A, here amplitude is Y. In this case frequency is omega, here also same the frequency is there, but only thing is that it is having some different phase angle. So in this A is amplitude of the sine wave, and omega is the frequency of the sine wave, and Y is the magnitude of the output sine wave, and phi is the phase shift. So now we will start understanding what do you mean by a Bode plot, because actually it is a plot in the frequency domain which will give us idea about the system stability. So Bodin, similarly we will see for the real zero, that is first order factor, where now the numerator term, that is s plus 1 type of, so s upon omega 0 plus 1, if this kind of zero if it is there, so how we can make the magnitude plot of it. So for low frequency asymptote at 0 decibel, so you will have the straight line horizontally low frequencies, and for high frequencies you will get the slope of positive 20 decibel per decade. So again here you can see that corner frequency. Now and you will get this particular plot of phase for the first order factor or called like real zero, and the magnitude after magnitude plot, it is phase plot. So for low frequency asymptote it is 0 degree phase, and at high frequency asymptote it is plus 90, and there again connections will be by a straight line in between these two of 0.1 omega 0 to 10 times omega 0. So now this is the quadratic transfer function if it is there, means second order. So for second order quadratic transfer function, we can have this kind of magnitude plot and this kind of phase plot. So magnitude and phase plot are shown here, and different values of zeta are used, that is damping coefficient are used. So when there is no damping, it may go to the infinity, and when the damping is present, so you will start getting a curve like this. So more is damping, the amplitude of this peak will go on decreasing. So now we will see how we can estimate the transfer function from the Bode plot in the next video. Thank you.